You're welcome to this edition of Scholars Universal School Business Studies online class. Last class we were able to discuss about the consumer rights and responsibilities, and we understood the rights and responsibilities of consumers. So in this class for today, we'll be talking about shopping tips. Now, you know, at the end of this class, we are supposed to be able to define needs and wants. We're supposed to be able to differentiate between the needs and wants. And you're supposed to state the steps involved in making decision about needs and wants, and also be able to explain impulse buying. And lastly, you should be able to explain or identify after sales services available to consumers on products and services and their importance. Alright. Now when we talk about needs and wants. Now first of all, before we move into this class, I want you to be able to, you know, get a sheet of paper, write those things you think you want, those things you want. All ensure you try to write at least what you want. All what you want. As soon as you're done with that, now take your time to check through all those things you've written and tick the ones you think you need right now, those things you think you need right now, out of those things you want. So if you're finding it difficult to be able to, you know, itemize all of these things or to pick, I think you need to be able to, you know, calm down and get to know what want and need means. Now what is need? You know, needs are things of necessity or obligation. You know, we say needs. They are things that are necessary. They are necessary and essential materials needed or required to live a fulfilled life. In fact, needed to survive. They are always associated with the basic needs of life. You know, such as, you know, you will agree with me that if you did not eat for days, it might be difficult to survive. So, you know, we have some philosophers that have worked on the basic needs of man. You know, when we talk about the basic needs of man, we are saying food, clothing, and shelter. That is, one thing that people need so much is food. You know, we need to eat food to survive. After food, we need clothing. At least you can't be naked. You have to get something to wear. You need clothing. And you need shelter. You have to get a roof, that is house, to be able to stay, to at least to survive. So needs, we say they are things of necessity or obligations. They are important. You know, they are basic needs. They are basic to human existence. You know, somebody who has not eaten for the past 3 days need food to survive. Abi, so someone traveling also needs a means of transportation. And finally, somebody that is thirsty needs something to quench the thirst, which could be water, soft drink, tea, etc. So what, now you've understood what needs means. Needs are things of necessity or obligations. Now what are wants? What are human desires? What you desire? You know, the items that somebody wishes to have. For example, Mr. Lucky has not eaten for the past 3 days. So you will agree with me that he needs food. But you know, but has decided to choose rice and beans to satisfy his deeper needs. That is, you know, someone that has not eaten for the past few days would want, you know, he might want to eat shawarma, he might want to eat rice and beans. He might want to eat beans. He might want to take swallow. You know, there will be so many things that he would want to eat. But we know that one thing that he needs is food. Food is needed. While rice and beans are what he wants, you know, he wants to eat rice and beans. But one thing he needs is food. If he does not eat rice and beans, if he takes bread. Bread is also a food. That is, bread needs are necessary. What are just human desire? Take for instance, you will agree with me. If I ask you what you want now, just, you know, I have a very good friend, you know, Fadia, blessed. If you ask him, what do you want? He will tell you, he wants Mercedes Benz. He wants a car. He wants to get power bike. He wants to get so many things. But the question is, the boy that I'm talking about is less than 15 years old. If you ask him, do you actually need that car right now? You are not up to 15. Do you need the car? And he will say no. Although he wants it, is his desire. Wants are desires, but needs are what you need to survive right now. Those are your obligations. So the needs are basic. They are things of obligations. So one can therefore seen as picking an item out of several items to satisfy deeper needs. As all needs cannot turn out to be wants, so also all wants cannot turn out to demands because of scarcity of resources. You know, you want many things, but because of, you know, your resources, of course, if you ask, you know, blessed, that this Mercedes Benz that you want, can you actually go and get it? He will not be able to get it because of the resources that is required. That is, he does not have money, he does not have kudi, he does not have ego, the money to be able to go and purchase to buy that Mercedes Benz. So once backed up with purchasing power is called demand. So demand is the goods that a consumer is willing and able to buy. That is willing, that is he wants to buy, able, that is he has the money to be able to buy it. So not until when you have the purchasing power is what we call money, your wants is not or cannot be termed as a demand yet. So wants is human desire, needs are things of necessity to survive, and demands are wants that is backed up with purchasing power. So that is that about wants and needs. Now, what are the difference between wants and needs? Number one, man can do away with needs. Man cannot do away with needs. You cannot do away with food. You cannot do away with shelter. You cannot do away with clothing. But what could be done away with, as there are many items that could be used to satisfy the needs. Take for instance, if you need food and you are telling me, oh, you want rice and beans. My brother, if you can find just rice and you take just rice, will you not be okay? Will you not be satisfied? At least you will survive. So what I'm saying is, man cannot do away with needs. That is, you have to get what you need. But once, you can do away with wants. You can pick out of everything you want. You can pick some things and you will survive. So the next thing is, needs comes first while wants follow. You have not eaten for days. The first thing, what do you need? Food. Then you cannot think of, okay, what kind of food can you eat? You cannot think of, oh, okay, should you buy pizza or should you buy shawarma? Or if you not check your money and you think that, oh, okay, you don't have enough to buy pizza or shawarma, then you cannot go for, can I buy beans only? Okay, can I buy just bread only? Or if you do not have even money for beans or bread, oh, can I buy just chin chin? Can I buy step on chin chin? Do you understand? So needs come first while wants follows. The next difference is, need is basic to human existence while wants could be luxury. Need is basic. That is, what do you need? You need food, you need clothing, you need, you know, shelter. Unlike wants, what could be luxury? Look at what I asked my friend, what do you want? He's telling me Mercedes Benz. Of course, that is what he wants. It is luxury. If you ask some people, what do they want? They will tell you they want chain. They want clothes for party. They want shoes. They want things that are luxury. So need, but however, need is basic. So the other difference, which is the last, is need is always urgent. Why wants may not be urgent. Need is always urgent. Someone has not eaten for days. If you ask them, what do you need? He can't be telling you he needs Mercedes Benz. He will tell you you need food. So need is always urgent. Why wants may not be urgent. Alright? So now we are moving to the next part, which are the steps in making decisions about dates and want. What are the steps? Now the first winning one is problem recognition. Now you need to, what are the steps needed to make needs, to make decision about needs and wants? Number one, I'm asking my friend, take for instance, he has not eaten for days, maybe for 40 days. The first thing you have to check, okay, I'm asking you, blessed, what do you want to eat? Oh, I mean, blessed, what do you need? I'm sure what the first you have to, you know, you have to recognize is the problem he's having, and the problem is he's hungry. Hunger is the problem. So he will tell you, you know, consumer will be aware of the problem. He is aware that his problem is hunger. So you have to recognize the problem. That's the number one, you know, step in making decision. The problem could be internally or externally stimulated, just like, you know, the hunger of blessed. Hunger. He would recognize that he is hungry. And number two is he has to search for information. But this is when, you know, information search is the second step. You know, it is when consumer examines the available item that could be used to satisfy needs and wants. So, you know, is number one is he's hungry. Number two, search for information available. Search for the items that you can use to satisfy your needs and wants. Ah, yeah, hunger. And you know what he needs is food to conquer the hunger. So information search is the next one. As soon as he gets that, oh, okay, food. And you know, we're talking about food. There are different foods that you can take. It can take noodles, it can take gari, it can take pizza, it can take burger, it can take shawarma. The next thing is evaluation of alternative. You have to evaluate the alternative. When you're talking about evaluation of alternatives, yeah, they and the available alternative will be evaluated against the benefit expected so as to ensure the greatest satisfaction. You will check, okay, I have 100 naira. Hey, if I go and buy noodles, I have just 2 noodles. Will 2 noodles be okay to, you know, fill my stomach? Or should I go and buy beans and put enough gari? Or should I go and buy just rice? So evaluation of alternatives, you are checking, oh, I have 100 naira, should I go and buy this thing? Or should I buy Costa biscuits? You understand? So you evaluate your alternatives. Don't forget, the number one is problem recognition. Number two is information search. Number three is evaluation of alternatives. And the last one is purchase decision. After you have considered your alternative, you now make decision. Now this is where consumer commits his resources on the selected product or services. Okay, I think if I buy beans, I'll be okay because beans is plenty. Eh? That woman will sell enough beans for me. Yakulele will sell enough beans. So if I eat beans, I'll be okay. So we have 4 steps. Number one is problem recognition. Number two, information search. Number three, evaluation of alternatives. And number four, purchase decision. So that is that. Now I'm moving to the next part, which is impulse buying. Now impulse buying, what is impulse buying? You know, these are purchases that are not budgeted or planned for. You know, there are some times that when we follow mommy or daddy to the market or to the shopping mall or to the supermarket, what we notice is there are some things that, you know, we will say, okay, we want to go and buy this thing, maybe we want to go and buy ice cream. But when we get there, you just see some biscuit and you say, daddy, I want that biscuit. That thing is what we call impulse buying. That is, you are buying things that you've not budgeted for or you've not planned for. You know, it happens when a customer buys a product at the point he notices it without having budget for such product. And it can be seen as extra budgetary spending. That is, you did not plan for them. You went to the supermarket to go and buy clothes. You did not plan, and when you get there, you notice something. You notice soap, or you notice another thing, or another food, and you say, "Daddy, no, I want that." That kind of thing is what we call impulse buying. So buying something you did not plan or you did not budget for. Now, what are the effects of impulse buying? Number one, effect is cost reduction. You know, at times you could buy some things because the buyer did not, you did not budget for it, and it makes the buyer to negotiate below the selling price. Take for instance, you want to buy things. You say, daddy, I want this. And daddy went there, he said, well, how much are you buying this thing? They said it's 100 naira. But daddy, because you did not plan for it, you can only afford 15 naira. You're telling, okay, sell this thing for me 15 naira. You know, at times, if you want to leave that place, they will tell you, oh, okay, come back, come and pay the money. You enjoy cost reduction. because number one, you did not plan for it, and number two, the money you have left is not up to the amount they are calling in. So you are telling them to sell it to sell it for you, or to sell that thing for you at that reduced price. So because they are selling it for you at that reduced price, you are enjoying cost reduction. Number one, the cost of the goods you are buying may be reduced. Now number two, what could be the effect? It may lead to the consumer running out of cash, as it will commit, as the consumer will commit money on the product he did not budget for. Take for instance, okay, you have 15 naira left with you, and you have got to buy that thing. So definitely you will not have any money with you again. So you are going to be running out of cash. You run out of cash if you engage in impulse buying. Number three is may lead to an enhanced profit. You know, when there is cost reduction, the profit is enhanced. Take for instance, you're going to the market to buy something to sell, and when you saw that thing, normally it's supposed to be 100 naira, and you negotiate or you bargain, you drag the price to 15 naira, and you also want to sell that thing. You now sold the thing for 120. Normally you're supposed to have sold that thing for 100 naira. You're selling for 120. So you're selling for 120 something you have bought for 15 naira. So you notice that you have made a profit of 70 naira. So you have more profit because you have bought or purchased that thing at a reduced price. So the fourth advantage is, you know, family disapproval, as all member of the family might have not been carried along while deciding. You know, there are sometimes that mommy will come from the market and, you know, she will buy something that you did not even plan or you did not tell her before, not because of any other thing, but because of impulse buying. And the effect of impulse buying is, take for instance, if you do not like that thing, or maybe mommy you are expecting, or mommy wants to buy a cloth for you, and you are expecting something, I mean ready-made, something big, but because mommy got to the market and she found something very very cheap, she decided to buy that thing for you, and by the time she got home, you realize that you do not like what mommy has bought. So in that case, there will be family disapproval, as you know, you have not agreed and you have not been carried along with what to get. All right, so lastly, you know, if the consumer does not enjoy the expected satisfaction, he or she will feel guilty and disappointed. That is, if he or she does not enjoy satisfaction from what he has planned for, or what he has bought without making plans for, he would be filled with guilt, and you know, he will regret his decision. So those are the effects of impulse buying. So we are going to the last part of this class, which is after sales services. Now we talked about after sales services. You are saying that these are post-purchase services rendered by the supplier to the consumer or customer or buyer in order to ensure that he or she enjoys satisfaction expected from the product. You know, we have a number of us that, okay, our daddy or our mommy has bought something, and you realize that it is the company or the people that are selling that thing that will come and fix that thing. Take for instance, satellite dish. You know, most of us that we buy or we got, you know, satellite dish or DSTV or GoTV or antenna, by the time we got those things, you will see that there will be some, you know, electrician or technicians that, you know, the seller had assigned to come and help us to fix those things. So all of those things is what we call after sales service. After sales services, you have bought that thing, so the person, that the seller, will now, you know, give us something else to make us enjoy the service. It could be maybe asking us, or you know, asking to come and fix that thing for us in our house, or it could be, you know, granting warranty, or say, take for instance, we have a number of us that after getting phone, you can ask daddy, they give them warranty on that phone, that if you use this phone for 1 year and it spoils within that 1 year, you can bring it back to our company, we will repair it for you at no cost. That is, they will not collect money from them for repairing it. And the essence of after sales service is to ensure that buyers are retained. You know, when you enjoy the service that a producer or a seller gives you, you always want to go back to that producer to buy goods from them, because you know that they will treat you well. And they render all possible services after the consumer must have been must have purchased so as to be happy about both the company and its product. You know, after sales service may include one warranty. I've mentioned warranty, and it's also like warranty is a written agreement in which a seller promises to repair the product, especially if it damaged within a particular period of time. So warranty, take for instance people that bought phone that's mobile phone. We have people that bought refrigerators. We have people that bought, you know, so many things, refrigerator, generators, you know, we have people that bought electronics. You know, we are talking about all those electronic gadgets, and they will tell you that if this thing gets spoiled or within a particular period of time, you can always return them for fixing. So that is warranty. And you know, warranty is a type of after sales service, because they have made, you know, those are the help that suppliers do for customers after they have made their sales. After sales service, there are some people that will even tell you, and then another type of after sales services, you know, after you have bought, they will tell you, let me call someone to come and take it, you know, a driver to come and take the goods you have bought to your house. All of those things are after sales services, because it is an help that is rendered to the customer after sales have been made. Okay, another type of after sales service is installation. I've mentioned installation. So this is when the manufacturer provides the necessary technical assistance needed to install an item of equipment purchased by the consumer or customer so that they work in accordance with specification. It's just like the fixing of the DSTV decoder the satellite that I've told you. You know, after buying Go TV or DSTV, they will give you one technical person to follow you to go and install it for you. Like if after buying generator at times, they give someone to follow you to go and fix it and the likes like that. So that is what we call after sale services. Alright, so that takes us to the end of the class for today. Thank you for listening. If you have any question, please don't hesitate to send to us. Please ensure you like this video and subscribe to our channel. Thank you and stay safe.